Okay, well, thank you very much, Mike. So our next speaker is Nathalie Rochefort. She is a neurophysiologist, also based here in the University of Edinburgh. And as I said, there are going to be a lot of very abrupt transitions in this workshop. So we shift from a medieval historian to a neurophysiologist, but they both analyze documents, but very different ones. So, all yours, Nathalie.
Yes, thank you, Miguel. So, indeed, I'm a neurophysiologist and I'm analyzing experimental data, in the sense data produced by experiments we are doing in the laboratory. So, very different from medieval archives. But I will first introduce briefly the field and my focus, the focus of my research, and then I will show you the documents, which are movies in that case, and how we analyze that. So, that's what I'm interested in, how brain networks, how the neurons in the brain are processing sensory information. So how the outside world, for example in this stressful situation, is represented inside your brain and how it is processed in order to generate behavior, a motor movement that is relevant for this situation. In other words, how the behavioral context modulate neuronal activity in a specific part of the brain, which is the visual cortex, located here in humans. So, I'm focusing my research on the neurons that are located in this part of the brain, the primary visual cortex, the first cortical location receiving visual information from the eye, to subcortical nuclei, to the first relay in the cortex, and then information is processed by other areas. And to before showing you the raw data, the experimental data, I'm just showing you here to give you an idea of the scale we are looking at. So we cannot image in the human brain from now on at a cellular resolution. So what you can do, if you want to study the human brain, you can put someone in a big scanner and do what is called functional magnetic imaging, so fMRI, and you will have some maps, and you will see some activated domains, depending on the task or which type of stimulus the person is looking at, and this will be in the scale of the millimeters, and the best, but more centimeters, so you will see location. But a neuron, a given neuron, is around 10 micrometers. This case, so much smaller. And we cannot have such resolution, not yet, in a human brain. So in order to study how individual neurons process information, I'm studying an animal model, which are mice, and I'm labeling these neurons with a specific fluorescence indicator. So the neurons in the region of interest are labeled with a fluorescent indicator, and this indicator will report the activity of neurons by changing fluorescence when the neurons are activated. So I'm showing you here an example of labeling. So we are imaging the labeled neurons throughout the different layers of this part of the brain, of the cortex, and we are then imaging these neurons with such device. So this is the type of, this is an experimental room where we are doing the experiments. The mouse is located here, running on the board, and below, located under a microscope. This is the type of technology you need to acquire. So this is just a schemata. You have the mouse running on the board, the microscope. You have cameras tracking the movement of the mouse, the pupil dilation, and the animal is placed in front of the screen or different screens, and it can present different visual stimuli. And this is the document. This is with all this technology. So this is the type of movie, and this is the type of data we are looking at. So we are recording movies of these neurons that are fluorescently labeled, and we monitor the changes of fluorescence during time. Right? So I explained you this movie. The animal is under the microscope, right? The neurons are labeled, and we are presenting very basic visual stimuli on the computer screen. And these are these bars oriented in different orientations, right? So the animal is looking at the screen, and we want to know, okay, what the neurons are doing in the visual cortex while the animal is looking at these stimuli. And this is what you see during the screen. So you are sitting in this room, and you have your computer, and that's what you see, that this given neuron here, the fluorescence pump will increase for a given stimulus. You will see again, now it's quite silent. And for the same orientation, which is now, boom, you have an increase of fluorescence. Meaning the neuron is activated for only a given orientation of the stimulus, right? So we have selective, specified neurons responding for a specific stimulus. And the way we are analyzing the movie, what we want to extract from the movie is this type of traces, which are the changes of fluorescence across time. So it's just, we plot at the beginning, you see, no change in fluorescence. In this region of interest, boom, an increase of fluorescence. So that's what we are plotting, these traces, changes of fluorescence across time. And we correlate these traces with the different orientations of the stimuli. So for example, here you have an example of the traces in for this given neuron. We compare to the different orientations we are showing, and we see that, oh, this neuron was very specialized, responding only for this orientation. Okay, and we do the same type of correlations, not only with the visual stimulus, but also with the behavior of the mouse, was it running or not, or was it involved in a task, or was it awake or sleepy, this type of correlation. Okay. So now, so what are the challenges? Because I'll show you kind of the end result, but we have many steps, and this is what is document analysis for us in my field, it's analyzing these movies. So the first challenge is the movement. Any imaging, in physiology at least, the enemy is movement, because if your object of interest is out of focus, you don't have information. So you want to keep your neurons in the same field of view. You need to focus on some neurons, and you want to keep them during the whole behavior of the whole stimulus. So you have an animal that is alive, that is moving, and you have brain movement. So you have to compensate for these movements. Find some tricks to minimize this movement. By the way, it's the same if you have been in a scanner, you are asked not to move. So we have to minimize the brain movements, and we are training the mice to be quiet and to be calm, and that's why also we are using these wheels, because they like to run on wheels. So this is also a way to calm them. We are fixing the head under the microscope to limit these movements, but ultimately we have to correct for the XY movement. And I'll show you an example. The other challenge is to really extract this fluorescence across time in a given neuron, and to know that this signal is really coming from this neuron and not the neighboring one. And I will show you an example. And finally, we correlate the neuronal activity with the behavioral state of the animal. Again, you have challenges to really correlate well the time in terms of time scale and selectivity. And the last challenge, and I think this is a one where several disciplines converge, is now that the technology developed so that we generate so many data. We have 30,000 images that are play the movies per day, so you can imagine I have to calculate, so it's maybe 60,000 images per animal, and we will have many. So we are talking about hundreds of gigabytes of data. And in my field, it's very clear that now we need strong collaborations with the School of Informatics, which is very nice in Edinburgh next door. And we need these collaborations in order to process this data, because it's simply not the scale where we can qualitatively analyze it. If I'm sitting in front of these movies and looking what's going on, I will not extract the relevant information. So we need quantitative tools and computer power to process this data in a quantitative way in order to extract the information. So I just want to give examples of what we are looking at. So these are raw data, movies that are taken during the experiment, and this is before and after motion correction. So you see here these movements. This is just a region of interest to compare before and after motion correction. So we are using a software to compensate these XY movements, and this is essential for the next step, for the extraction of the changes in activity in the given neuron. And this needs a lot of computer power and specific software. So this is the type of thing where we need the help of either people doing computational neuroscience or who have programming skills. Another challenge is what I was telling you about, this extraction of the fluorescence for a given neuron. So this is another example of movie. And for example, I'm interested in this neuron. They want to know what is this activity of this neuron. And you can see that it's not always activated, so sometimes you see a bit of fluorescence, sometimes not. And you see all these processes around that are also lighting up from time to time. And it's important for an analysis that we extract the activity from individual neurons and from this specific neuron and not from this one. So the fluorescent changes in this neuron has to be specific and not contaminated by the processes coming from other neurons. I'm giving this example simply because, depending on the method you are using to extract this signal, you can end up with very different traces. So I'm not going into detail, but this is the type of traces of changes in fluorescence across time you could have for the same neuron, and you can see just by eye that it's very different, right? Depending on the method you are using. Yeah, I'm on the and this method you will use to extract the information, because finally this will be the type of trace you correlate with your visual stimulation or the behavior of the animal. This completely depends on the algorithm you will use to extract this information, right? And in order to control that and to be as close as possible as the physiological activity of the neuron, to know the physiological activity of the neuron, you have to check and to control what this type of algorithm is doing with your from your raw data. And again, qualitatively, I'm sitting in front of this movie and trying to know what this neuron and all the others are doing, I will not manage. So you start a program, you use these programs to analyze your thousands and thousands of images, you have the result, and then you need really controls and go back and be sure that what you have as a result is really the activity you are looking at, right? And not contaminated or just distorted by the analysis process. So, just to summarize, these are our raw data, videos, series of images of these neuronal populations. We also have, because we correlate this with behavioral parameters, so in that case it's the wheel speed, the speed of the wheel, the time and the characteristics of the visual stimuli, what is presented. I was mentioning the pupil diameter that is used as a parameter of the attention, so as a measure of attention and the weightiness. And the video of the animal, just the video of the behavior of the animal. And we, in order to extract the quantitative measures from the neuronal activity, we need to process these images to extract the fluorescence changes in individual neurons. These are the traces I was showing you, and we correlate these changes in fluorescence with the behavioral state of the animal. So we align in time the changes in fluorescence with each quantitative measure of the animal's behavior. And we extend this analysis to all the neurons that were imaged. So we have population of neurons, not only one or two, but population of neurons. And in order to then say, okay, what the neurons are doing when the animal is running, or what the neurons are doing in order to process visual information, we have to take all this information and then try to either make a model of what the neural populations are doing, or at least to extract specific correlations between the type of activity and the type of behavior. This is the process that we are doing. And I just want to thank the people, the lab members, and the founders, the Wellcome Trust and the Royal Society. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Nathalie. So, yeah, excellent timekeeping as well. So we've got time for a couple of questions as well.
I was really, it was really interesting contrast between the two types of documents. And one of the things that I thought was kind of interesting for you is that your document, because they've become so numerous in a way, it's kind of qualitatively changed what it is. So with Mike, you had two interpret documents himself. But with you, you almost need another set of experts to interpret your documents because they've become so many. I just wondered how that changes kind of your
ownership
of interpretation and
things like that. Yeah, that's a bit what I was saying, the sense that the technology developed so much, but now we are reaching a time where we need tools to analyze this amount of data. You have a history of the field, so it started much more qualitative in the sense that this type of orientation selective neurons that I was showing, at the beginning, they were revealed in the 60s with electrophysiology. So, electrodes in the brain to record the electrical activity, and Hugel and Wiesel in the 60s, but were basically showing different ratings or oriented bars. And hearing, because you had the speaker linked to the electrodes that were recording that activity. And each time they were presenting the good orientation, then you would hear electrical activity. Whereas with bad orientation, nothing. And so at the beginning, you had more qualitative way to analyze. Because you could still quantify the number of electrical impulses, for example. But it started like this, one neuron by one neuron, and saying, okay, this neuron is selective, this neuron is selective, right? Now, the techniques, and especially the development of imaging techniques, allows you to record many, many neurons at the same time, doing many things, and not only for one stimulus, because we are not just paralyzed looking at one bar, right? We move, we interact, we are awake, so suddenly you have dimensions. A bit for the medieval, is as if suddenly you wanted to know not only this merchant at this place, but, okay, what was the wall? Trading business in the 14th century between France and Turkey, all the merchants, what were they selling, how fast, with who. So suddenly you have many more parameters and you need to correlate them. And you alone sit with your book, you cannot have that. Yeah. So you need your two first data, and then you need tools to correlate all these parameters. So in that sense,
any other question? Yeah, Robert, please.
Yeah, given the volume of data you can collect this way, is it actually feasible to keep everything, or do you have to?
Yeah, it's a challenge indeed. I think I put it in one of the. Yes, you need big servers. I had mentioned archive issues. So indeed, you need big servers to store all this data, and you need a full data management plan, which is now a bigger and bigger concern for the universities and also the funding agencies. So it's a requirement that all published data, at least what is published, should be archived and also public, so accessible. And these are raising really challenges in terms of cost, money, and in, yeah, you need, as I said, data management plan. So each experiment is archived at the end of the day. Then we have another copy in the lower server, and the analysis is made on a third copy that is processed. And we are keeping, then we are keeping the, yeah, well, that's the global. But indeed, yes, these are definitely some issues that involve infrastructure and cost, and that has now starting to be taken by the university or funding agencies, that they realize this challenge, simply that a lot of universities do not have the resources. So a lot of data are actually just stored in private, in Amazon.
Okay, thank you very much, Natalie.